another topic that I have been kind of mulling around over is, or mulling over rather, is toxic masculinity. And I have been, obviously don't subscribe to toxic masculinity, but I also am not sure if I even subscribe to the idea of the term. Because in many ways, I have found that this is a very cloaked way at targeting Black men. And
a very overt way of targeting Black men.
Thank you. And, you know, there are parts of our culture and in ways in which inherently we move as Black people that are intimidating to the masses, right? Yep. And I have found that toxic masculinity is a way in which many intellectuals, many Twitter thinkers, and internet folks have used it as a way to weaponize how Black men move in the world.
Yep.
And so I would love to kind of get your thoughts on that. And yeah, we'll start there. I would love to get your initial thoughts.
This is great. Yeah, I definitely see it as a way, it's an extension of a forcible effeminization of Black culture. And I think the first time that I ever started considering the negativity around toxic masculinity is having someone tell me that machismo is not an appropriate word to say, because they linked it to the idea of toxic masculinity. And that for me linguistically was a moment where I was like, okay, well, what are we doing? Because here's a Latinx word that is used to describe denotatively a positive look at somebody who is inhabiting this certain way around them that culturally might not fit into white culture's expectation.
Right.
Of what is an appropriate manhood. But if we think of the ways that this kind of surreptitious idea that white masculinity is a little bit more passive and a little bit
beta.
Yeah, a little bit more beta. Does that mean healthier? Does that mean less abusive? Does that mean less corrupt? And the answer unilaterally is no, because the only reason that you're taking power away from men in these other cultures, whether it be indigenous culture, which has a beautiful and strong history of also the looking across the polarity of gender, and then we have that in a lot of West African conversations as well. You know, we've taken that out, that there used to be this idea that masculinity itself carried a spectrum. And what we're doing is we're attaching alphaness to toxicity.
Yes.
Which allows anyone under the radar of that to get away with the kinds of really terrible things that they're doing. I think the movie The Social Network, just in terms of a representation of how that's entered social media.
Gosh, I haven't dived in yet.
Oh, no, not the new documentary, but I was I was going back to like the fictional film about like how Facebook.
Okay.
A lot about those dudes. And I think a lot about how it is a white beta male culture that is now driving the ways that we think of ourselves socially and how we think of ourselves in terms of performance, how we think about needing to capitalize on certain aspects of our image. Right. And this is all driven by people who, one come out of a colonial ancestry, and did this, use the same kinds of tools to take us over, when we're looking at like regions and cultures. And now we're seeing the same thing happen in terms of what's allowed for us as individual people, that you're not supposed to signal as being proud of inhabiting a certain amount of masculinity or a certain alpha masculinity. You're supposed to think of that as representative of you being dumb or uneducated or violent. And that's not related to being a very particular kind of man. It can go anywhere across the spectrum. of how you've decided to treat women, how you've decided to treat non-binary people, how you've decided to treat masculine bodies that might inhabit more femininity than you deem comfortable with.